Hey, welcome back. The second lecture for Shasta College Humanities 2 Film Studies. Today is Wednesday. What I'm going to try to do is post at least two of these a week, Monday and Wednesday, because normally that's when we'd be in the class together. That's when you'd have to listen to me drone on and on anyway. So why not listen to me online? I'll try to make it as consistent as possible. So there'll be two of these lectures, usually a week. I won't overwhelm you with too much stuff. People keep asking about Zoom. Zoom has been kind of a hassle for me. And so I'll be doing YouTube for a while. I may still try to do a group meeting on Zoom, but there's a lot of you. And I don't know how beneficial that'll be, but I'm still working on that, the kinks on that, okay? So today, I hope you went and looked at announcements. That's really important, the key to the course, because I made an announcement for you guys to check out this documentary, part one of a documentary that is called The Story of Film, which is essentially the same as your textbook. Hopefully you're going to buy this soon because I'm going to assign readings to this next week. So please buy it, rent it, borrow it. Just don't steal it. Get it somehow. It's going to help you get through the course. The book follows the documentary. The book is more detailed than the documentary. And so what the documentary doesn't show, the book fills in the spaces. And so much of what's in the book I can't cover because it's so much, because we've got to keep moving through the decades. What I try to do in this course is go decade to decade. And right now we're in the early first decade of filmmaking, which started in about late 1880s, but really didn't get going what you might call an actual film with a story till 1901, 1902. I know, seems like a long time ago for you all. It was. But we're going to go decade to decade. So right now, we're doing the first 10 years. By the time we're done with this course, we'll be up to current. The 2020 years. But right now, we're starting early days. So go look at the announcements. Find the documentary. It's on YouTube, and it'll say Part 1, Story of Film by Mark Cousins, Story of Film and Odyssey. But you have to pay $1.99 for it. If you want to do that, you can rent it for $1.99. Or another option is to go to the Shasta College website and go to the library, go to streaming video, and click on Canopy, and it's on Canopy, same title. It's all on announcements. Story of Film by Mark Cousins, Part 1, although I think their parts are listed under titles like Birth of Cinema and the Hollywood Dreams. So go look at those two. And that's free. What you're going to have, if you haven't used Canopy yet, you got to sign up. You got to sign in, and with using your student ID and or your library card, I think both. Anyway, but that's no charge to you. The college pays for that. So that's available for streaming. So this week, please watch that. And then we'll talk about that more next week. Once you get the book, hopefully in the next week or so, I will be signing those chapters. And so hopefully the book, you'll catch up to the documentary in the book and you'll be good to go. Another thing I want to assign you right now is, it's not an assignment, but it's essentially a discussion. I want you, remember how you discussed last week, introducing yourself and a little bit about your feeling about movies. Well, this week I want you to go on YouTube. It's free, folks. You don't have to pay for it. And watch a film called A Trip to the Moon. 1905, I believe, by Georges Millet. He's a Frenchman. He is almost like the godfather of cinema in a way. He started storytelling like no one had done before. And the trip to the moon is a trip indeed, folks. It's almost like a psychedelic freak show trip, made with sets and very inventive camera work, although it's very flat, meaning the camera doesn't do much besides photograph things, like a stage play from a distance. That's how they used to make movies before the language of cinema popped up its head, and I'll talk about that in a minute. So go watch Trip to the Moon. You may have seen parts of it. You may have heard about it. You may have seen pictures from it. It is essentially, I guess you would say, the first sci-fi film ever made. It's only 10 minutes long, so it shouldn't stress you out too much. It is in black and white, folks, and it does have music, but no sound, no verbal talking. And so I want you to look at it closely and tell me what you see. Tell me what you think you see. And when I say it's kind of a psychedelic trip, if you understand what I'm saying, it is definitely avant-garde. Psychedelic is a term from the 60s, folks, where hippies used to take drugs and get crazy with rock and roll and dancing naked out in the parks and stuff as the Vietnam War was raging and bringing in young guys for military service. Your grandparents would know about psychedelic. Anyway, look at it. Tell me what you think. I'll put that in the announcements also to remind you if you don't watch this in time. Anyway, so that's your assignment this week. Watch those two films I just told you on Canopy or YouTube. And then the silent film by Georges Millet, The Trip to the Moon. Later on, maybe some of you have seen this movie. A couple of years ago, they did a 3D movie called Hugo, based on a children's book that Martin Scorsese wrote. He didn't write it, but he directed it. And it is based, a large part of the subtext of that movie is the making of Trip to the Moon. And if you ever haven't seen the film, it's a very clever film where a young child meets Georges Millet, the filmmaker, and gets to observe the making of that incredible short film that changed the face of cinema. That's all I did, folks. Nothing too big. So go do those things. That's your assignments this week. Don't worry about any graded assignments yet. That'll start next week. But I do go look at your participation in these things. And you've got to let me know you're participating in the discussions. I do go and look at it to see if you're replying. So in the discussion, make your statement, what you think is going on, what you feel about it, and then reply to two of your fellow students. That's what you got to do. Not too hard. We're not in the classroom together. You don't have to be embarrassed about raising your hand and talking in front of people. Now you get to just talk with your fingertips on the keyboard. And you're all texting crazily, right? You're all texting right now, probably. So just think about the conversation is texting. That's okay. That's cool. The other thing I want to cover today is the early chapters of the book. I know most of you don't have it, but you'll see it in the documentary. I can still talk about it. When film started, it was a huge novelty. Nobody knew what to do with it. At first, it was just simple images of people walking in city streets, people not even in cars, because very few cars are invented yet. But there's a famous film, a clip of a film. You'll see it in the documentary. You'll read about it in the chapter. It was made in London, not London, I'm sorry, Liverpool, and England. And it's simply a train coming into a train depot. When this was filmed, believe it or not, people had never seen anything like it. The train appears to be moving on the screen. The train appears to be moving towards people. And people who saw it in gatherings and movie theaters literally jumped out of their seats and hid on the floor thinking the train was coming through the screen. That's how vivid it was. That's what a revolution it was to see this. I know it sounds impossible, but I know some of you are hiding under your seats when you watch the newest horror film. I know you are. It's a similar thing. You think you've seen it all, and then here comes a new horror film, and it's truly terrifying, and now you're seeing something else. Well, this was a phenomenon, this train coming towards people. It freaked them out. But people paid attention. People want to be movie makers. They saw the potential of an audience and how the visual, what they're seeing on screen, could be expanded into possibly telling a story that's longer than 1 minute clip of a train coming towards you. And so they started seeing different possibilities. And so a guy like George Millet comes along and he does an actual story with actors, very hammy actors, and with sets, very kind of cool sets, but very corny. And when you watch Trip to the Moon, you'll notice how the acting is very gesture laden because nobody's speaking, because there's no sound for recording dialogue. And so early movies were silent, and the acting was different than it is now. So it's hard to sometimes look at those old films and go, oh, it looks so hokey or corny. Well, it wasn't. They had to pantomime everything. They had to pantomime their emotions, and they did it with a lot of hand gestures, with a lot of overt physical gesturing. Like, for example, if somebody was anxious, they're like this on the screen, rubbing their hands anxiously. That's how they're showing how anxious they are, nervous. Or they'll be like this. They're nervous. And so that's how they had to get their emotions across to the audience. And so their gestures are big. Their emotions are big to get the visual concept of the story to the audience. Now, what you're not going to see in this early films, or what you might call any sort of modern techniques in cinema, what they didn't do in these early on films, they didn't have close-ups. Like right now, this is a close-up, folks. This is not a close-up. And most of the films were filmed from this vantage point, like the cameras in the audience in a theater. And so the actors are usually shown in full body. Not that I'm in full body, you don't want to see that. And you don't see their faces for the most part very clearly. And they're gesturing wildly. And you'll see that in The Trip to the Moon. But that was normal. That was common. That's how it was done. Nobody thought it was overly done or corny or hokey because that's what it was. There was no other way. Storytelling got more complicated when they finally somebody came up to figure out how to do a close-up. That way we could get people's expression in their eyes. They don't have to gesture wildly because we could be more subtle with a close-up. And then we can, from way back here, you can't even see anything, hardly, because I kind of disappear into the background. And that's a great background, by the way. Right over there is a self-portrait. There's another portrait up there. There's a poster from a play I do. This is a Sam Shepard play here. That's, believe it or not, that's Elvis Presley. young Elvis, and it's called Fool for Love. I saw many, many years ago, 40 years ago, with Ed Harris, Kathy Baker. And wonderful, wonderful play. Made it into a pretty good, cool movie with Sam Shepard. Robert Altman directed it. Check it out one day. We'll talk about it later. That's what that's in my background, if you're wondering what's going on back there. So the backgrounds are really important on Trip to the Moon. They got cutout sets. They're supposed to be on the moon. It's obviously they're not on the moon. They look like they have no concept what the moon looks like. And they're all breathing up there. They're not in spacesuits, folks. They're walking around with suits and ties on. So it's a little casual. It was a little, the science was a little off. Okay, so, but the storytelling is inventive and it's clever and it's entertaining. And that's what filmmaking essentially has become. When I asked you last week in your discussion, why do you go to movies? If we're in class, I ask that question. I go around the class, I ask everybody. And so many people say three or four of the same answers, usually. One of them is, I like to be entertained. Okay, that's valid. The other one is, I'm killing time. I don't like that one so much because life is short enough. You don't want to kill too much time. You want to elongate time as much as you can, believe me. Maybe not at your age, you believe that, but as you get older, you want time to slow down a bit. You don't want to kill any more time. The other thing they always say is I want to escape. I want to escape. You know, evidently the reality we're in here is upsetting or not comfortable, and so you escape into cinema. That's probably what I did when I was a kid. I loved going to the movies. I went to the movies literally. I started going about 5 years old. My mother would take me because my brothers did not want to go. My father didn't believe in movies. He thought they were a waste of time. And so I became my mother's co-pilot in movies. We started going to movies. And these weren't children's movies, folks. I was going to see what they called adult movies. And that's not adult with rated X or anything. They were grown-up movies coming out of Hollywood that starred the likes of Marlon Brando and Paul Newman and Jane Fonda and Sean Connery, and I never saw anything like it. Movies like HUD, Hustler, Cool Hand Luke, and my peers weren't allowed to see these movies. Their parents wouldn't allow them to see them because they were the complex adult stories. The Defiant Ones with Sidney Poitier and Tony Curtis about two cons, escape convicts, one a black man, one white, and they're chained together the whole movie and how they're escaping and how they start off in a adversary position because the white guy's a racist and Sidney Poitier is probably a racist too. And they have to learn how to work together if they're going to escape, and they learn how to accept each other's differences, meaning their skin colors, and how they end up back in prison, folks, but they've learned a huge lesson that their racism that kept them apart is a bunch of crap, and they don't want to live that way any longer. And so the film is brilliant that way, giving this depiction. And I saw that thing when I was about 6 years old. Now, did I understand it? Probably not. I thought it was kind of cool, them running around and jumping off trains, and they're running away from the cops. That's always fun. Did I probably understand the deeper implications of the story? No, but something was sinking in. And did I even know what a director was or a writer in those days? I did not. You mostly knew who the movie stars were. And even though maybe I didn't know their names because we didn't have Entertainment Tonight, we didn't have social networking, we didn't have all the junk we have now to look up every actor there is. You couldn't do that in those days. But we're aware of who those actors were, and we believed them, and the story is believable. Suspending disbelief is really important when it comes to any art form. but especially cinema. Because cinema, movies, fiction movies, narrative movies, I'm not talking documentary now, we'll talk about those later, need to suspend your disbelief, meaning they're not showing exactly real life. They are a dramatization of what life is, and so you can't hold their feet too close to the flames with reality, because essentially can't be done. But is it any less truthful? No, it's just, it is the holy truth. And so when people watch movies and look and say, well, the cops really don't behave that way, in my, you know, their opinion, or doctors don't really do that, well, maybe that's so. But it's movie logic, it's cinema logic, not real life logic. And you think all this stuff, if you've ever watched Grey's Anatomy, think any of that really happens in hospitals? Very little of it, probably. But would we watch it if it was just regular hospital life? Probably not. You want to watch nurses put bedpans under people and give them IVs and talk about what they're going to do next weekend? Probably wouldn't be that dramatic and wouldn't keep your attention. But do you want to see them bring in somebody who's been shot in a gang shooting, and he's bleeding to death, and they're trying to save his life, and his wife comes in, and the wife's boyfriend takes them all hostage? That's Hollywood, folks. Rarely happens in real life, but we believe it because we suspend our disbelief, because for dramatic purpose. They're telling a clever story. Is it a lie? Not really. It's the human condition. I get this all the time. People go, because I write fiction, people go, oh, it's all made up. Well, not really. It's life. Is it a made-up story? Maybe, but it's about life still. I'm still using people, conversations I've heard, locations I've been to. I'm trying to get at the truth of the human existence. It's not a lie. Did it happen? Probably not, but does it need to happen? Does every story we tell actually have happened? Very few of them. Folks, if you think Star Wars has happened, I got bad news for you. It hasn't. It was all filmed on a big set down in Hollywood. Sorry to break it to you. But is it any less truthful about the human condition? Absolutely, it's truthful, because we as human beings, we don't change. We're the same way we've been since early times when we lived in caves. We want things that we can't have. We fall in love with people we can't have. We are jealous of people who have something we want, whatever it is. And that story is as old as man. How we get what they want. When you guys, if you ever take a screenwriting class or you ever want to make a film, the first question is what do your characters want? Hopefully they want a lot. And then what you do, because if they don't want anything, you got a boring story of a bunch of slackers just sitting around not wanting anything. But if they want something, then you've got a grain of a story. And then after that, you start putting in obstacles to that character getting what they want. That's all movies are, putting in the obstacles, and how's the character going around the obstacle to get what they want, whether it's $1 million, that won't go too far nowadays, or it's the girl or the guy, whoever they're after. If they just get it real easy, then you get a really boring story. So you put a lot of barriers. What they say in screenwriting class, what makes a great screenplay is conflict, conflict, conflict. And throw in some more conflict and you'll be fine. And it's how your characters get around those conflicts. That's what makes this interesting story. And so when you're watching Trip to the Moon, look what the conflicts are. Look at that. Look at that language. What do they want? Simple as that. And what are the conflicts of getting what they want? When you look at the discussion, try to answer those questions. What do they want? And what are the conflicts that's stopping them from getting that? And what do they have to do to get around those conflicts? That's, I'll make those, when I put the discussion up there, I will put that in there to give you a little hint on what I would like you to talk about. So in the 1880s, Thomas Edison, the man who gave us the light bulb and phonograph and so much other stuff, gave us the movie camera. He also built the very first movie studio. It's in the documentary called The Black Mariah. It's in New Jersey. It's not out here, folks, not in Hollywood. That didn't come till later. And it's just a black box, very small. It's probably 200 square feet. You can tour it right now. It's on display. And it's just a simple black box where he made these simple little films to show what cinema could be. One of them is a dramatic. It's in the documentary. You'll see it. The Kiss, for once. It's two people, fully clothed folks, and they're kissing. Just for a moment. And that was so controversial at the time, it was almost considered pornographic. They didn't have that term in those days, but it's considered almost too risque to show. They showed two human beings kissing? How dare they? It was a controversy at the time. That's how radical it was. Believe it or not, you'll see it in the documentary, these two people kissing. It looks as innocent as possible, but it wasn't to the public at large. They were outraged and intrigued, and they wanted more. He has other things in there. He has the sneeze, a person sneezing. That's an entire film. And it's just a phenomenon watching humans do things. He has dancers dancing dancing still in one frame. They're not moving around. The camera's not moving. And these are his early films. And it's a clever studio because it's on wheels, on a track that's circular. Because he understood for film, you need a lot of light. And this is early, early days before they had high film stock. That was what they call high speed. And they needed a lot of light to get exposure. And so the roof opened up to the sun. And so he would move the black box to where the sun is so he could film the person, two people kissing, the guy sneezing, because he needed lots of light. Later on in France, Lumiere brothers took that and they expanded it. Maybe you've heard of the Lumiere theaters. They're everywhere. They're named after these two brothers in France who essentially took cinema, what Thomas Edison was doing, and they expanded it. They expanded the technology. They expanded the visual presentation. They essentially created first movie theaters where people actually sit and watch it on the screen. They created first sort of projectors to screen this big image on a big screen, and that blew everybody's minds. And now look at the screens we have now. They can't get big enough. You've all seen the big screens. The bigger, the better. Except for then the story's got to be bigger and bigger and bigger. And I'm not that enthralled with big screen stories because they're usually a little over the top. For my taste, I like small stories, small people in small towns doing small things. And you don't. But the big screen is pretty cool. I made a couple films that have been screened on big screens. It's a whole different experience than screening it on your computer or on your iPhone or your flat screen. It's a whole different experience. It's larger than life. And so that's what came out of Edison's inventions. And then the Lumiere brothers took it from there. This is all in the first chapters of the book. It's all in the first chapters of that documentary I want you to watch this weekend. Because the language of cinema was in its infancy when it first started, because there was no language of cinema. That got changed quickly when filmmakers started wanting to get close and see people's faces. In the early days, the silent film screen stars, nobody could recognize them unless they had kind of wild makeup on. funny hats, funny mustaches, funny wigs, because there was no close-ups of the human face. And so we couldn't really see what they looked like until later we got close-ups. And we'll talk about this guy next week, D.W. Griffith, who essentially created a lot of cinema language, and one of them was a close-up. He wanted to see people's faces. He wanted to see things. He moved the camera. Nobody had moved the camera before. He put it on a track, and he moved the camera. So the camera's moving in. It's moving out. It's dawling this way. It's going that way. It's panning this way. He created this language of cinema that hadn't been done before. And he did that 1910, 1915, 12, in that area. We'll talk about him next week. Anyway, movie theaters, we went from Nickelodeons. These are little machines that you put a nickel in, and you'd look through this little screen like this, and there'd be a 30-second little loop in there of a horse running or the train coming to the station or the two people kissing. That would be the entire movie. And it was so enthralling, people put another in, and they'd look at it again. Well, later on, the Lumiere brothers go, well, I think we should project these things into a screen so people will pay a fee to come into this building, sit down. And that started the whole movie theater phenomenon. And then they also started going, well, maybe people would like to have a snack. And so then we had food in the movie theaters, which I wish they didn't personally. Anyway, so the audience was growing with the technology. The audience wanted more than just seeing a 30-second kiss. They want to see more. And so when Georges Méliès made the trip to the moon, they saw a lot more. They really got their money's worth, and they wanted more after that. And people who were starting to make movies saw that need, that the public wanted to see these stories. Our stories, our collective stories up there on the big screen. Okay. Another thing that changed everything, I'll shut up here in a minute. Another thing that changed everything was editing. This is when you splice the film together and you tape it together. You know, sounds easy enough. But how to tell a story through editing is what changed cinema. They're just not hooking scenes together on in a linear fashion. That's not filmmaking. They started what they call parallel editing. Parallel, right? Two stories being told at the same time. Think about your movies now, television. We see that all the time now. We're on the main character, and then we see what's going on with another character. So we got Keanu Reeves and John Wick. He's doing his thing. Then we see the bad guy who's pursuing Keanu Reeves. He could be in another town. He could be in another country. But it's parallel, his story. And then we cut back to Keanu Reeves. Well, it was started, and it was a revolution. How to tell the story, two stories simultaneously, to enrich the story, to enrich the narrative. And parallel editing changed everything. I don't want to get too technical on you guys yet, because this isn't a filmmaking class, but you should learn some of these terms. I'm going to have a whole section next week on terminology. The French created most of it because they were real early pioneers of early cinema. What else? And then I'll let you go. Let's see. Watch The Trip to the Moon. Discuss it. Hugo reference. I think I've covered it all. Look at announcements. Look at the discussions. Discuss. Watch these films. Have fun. And stick it out. Stick through it. Yes, they're in black and white, and there's no sign, and there's no sound, but it's just think of it this. It's a cool, groovy new storytelling device that you haven't experienced. And that's always fun, to go into the unknown. And so the mystery of cinema and our story begins today. See you soon.